Hi, Katie.
Hi, Julie.
Thank you so much for joining me today to share your story. I'm super excited because I know you have a really great story to share with the audience. So, why don't you start by giving us a brief summary of your motherhood journey?
Sure. Yeah, my motherhood journey started when I separated from my first husband. I didn't have any kids. I was 38 years old, and I knew I wanted to get remarried. And about a year before I met my now husband, I actually drew a picture of him. And I can share that with you guys.
Yes, please. So you said you drew this picture a year before you met him? Okay.
Yeah, I drew
Oh,
the
that's right.
picture
It's on there. Okay.
in 2015, and I met him a year later. And by the time we got married in 2018, I was 43, and I was seeing some fertility doctors, and they basically told me that I had a less than 1% chance of having my own baby. I ended up having four miscarriages, and after the third miscarriage, my husband said, "Well, you drew me and you manifested me. So why don't you try drawing our future kid and trying to manifest our future kid?" So I did. I drew a picture in 2019, and 9 months later, I was pregnant with my now 2-year-old son, and I had him when I was 45. It was a healthy and normal pregnancy, and he's a healthy, normal baby, but very, very energetic.
As they should be. That's how you know they're normal, right?
Yeah, right.
And that they're healthy. That's a really wonderful story. So, what do you attribute to your success? Was it this manifestation part, this drawing bit, or do you also attribute other factors to it, to you being successful?
I will never know 100% what it was, but I think it was a lot of different factors combined. I think this was part of it. Making these drawings helped me believe that it was actually real and that it was going to happen one way or another. And I honestly, like, even right before I got pregnant with him, and I was 44 when I got pregnant, I just didn't believe that I was infertile, because the evidence didn't support that. I had been pregnant four times in my 40s. And I just had a really strong belief in myself, I guess. And I had gotten a little bit distrustful of doctors, fertility doctors, reproductive endocrinologists is what they're called. I guess that's the fancy
It
term for them. Because I'd been reading a lot of different books. I read a Chinese medicine book. I read a book about supplements. It starts with the egg. I started taking a lot of the supplements that were recommended in that book. And when I brought that up to the reproductive endocrinologists, they kind of like poo-pooed that. And so I think a lot of women, they're only comfortable going down the Western medicine route. And I think if they open their mind up to like other ways of manifesting their baby that were complementary, like Chinese medicine or manifestation or like supplements or whatever, I think that women would have more success and these reproductive endocrinologists wouldn't like dominate the field, because I don't think they necessarily need to. And after hearing more about your work, I feel even more strongly about that.
I agree 100% with what you said. And to be clear, it's not to say that, IVF or medicated fertility cycles aren't appropriate in certain situations, but they're certainly not the only tool and the only strategy that women have available to them. And so I do agree with you that women get a little or a lot too hyper-focused on doing it the traditional route, and in doing that, they exclude a lot of other options that are very viable and very effective, oftentimes even more effective than the IVF, because as you said yourself, you were given less than a 1% chance of success, right? Yeah. So how were you able, 1% chance of success is pretty dismal. So how are you able to ignore that coming from someone who has traditionally most people give a lot of authority to? This is a doctor. This is what they are doing as their career. So how are you able to ignore that and really be able to believe in yourself?
That's a really interesting question, and it's something that I've thought a lot about. So there's this one kind of strange thread throughout my whole life, and that's like my unwavering belief that I have perfect health, even when I don't. So just since I was a kid, I decided that I was going to live to be 100 years old, and I decided I'm only going to accept perfect health.
So why weren't you deterred by four miscarriages? Because that's a pretty significant number. Why did you still, how could you still have that belief in yourself, even with four miscarriages?
Because four miscarriages didn't mean I was infertile. It just meant I had four miscarriages. And I knew that when a woman gets to be in her 40s, that the chances of miscarriage increase significantly. And I also knew that having a baby in your 40s it's a numbers game, just like dating is a numbers game. Between when I got divorced and when I met my now husband, I went out on 25 first dates. And some people would have probably given up after 10. And some people might have given up after 20, but I kept going, and eventually I met a great man. And so I just thought that it was a numbers game. And eventually, God willing, I would, manifest the golden egg.
I love your perspective of how you had the positive reframe on that. Because a lot of women would look at the miscarriages as failures. And my interpretation of what you said is that you looked at it as opportunity, as your body telling you what was possible. And you held on to that until it became possible and it became real. Has that always been a philosophy that you've had in life, or is this something that you've worked on as an adult, or that you've come into as an
It's
adult?
something I definitely had to work on. I was a chronically depressed person in my 20s, and I would always see like the worst in everything. Even if something was like good, I would see the worst in it. And that was leading me down a path of like lifelong medicalization of my depression. I was on five different psychotropic drugs when I was in my early 20s. And I realized I just didn't want that for the rest of my life. And it was like this belief in that I had in only accepting 100% perfect health that kind of like got me out of that, and helped me look into other ways of dealing with the depression. So I didn't always have like a glasses half full attitude. I actually used to have a glasses half empty or like mostly empty attitude. It was just through a lot of personal development and just trying to solve my own problems, my own emotional problems, that I realized that having this positive attitude or being able to reframe a situation that wasn't what I wanted into, an opportunity that's super helpful for getting you through rough times.
So a lot of women are in that kind of situation where they're looking at the lack of not having the baby, and they're very focused on the problem of it and having a difficult time, and being able to look at be and they're having a difficult time holding on to the vision of their baby. Can you give any tips on for women on how they can have more of a positive mindset on the motherhood journey?
Yeah, so one thing that I know is super hard for women who are trying to conceive is seeing babies. And that was like super hard for me too. And so one trick I had to plan myself was every time I saw a happy family with like a new baby, I would say, that's amazing. That's wonderful for her, meaning the mom. I'm next. And that way I wouldn't like slide down the path of like seeing that everybody else has babies and I don't. I also just like I really became obsessed on figuring out like what the women who were getting pregnant were doing and trying to copy them. And that's why I went down the supplement route. I did do IVF. I think we had three IVF cycles and a couple of IUIs. And I had, I think, two miscarriages from the IVF cycles. Yeah, and just remember that in your 40s, it's kind of a numbers game.
And just to be clear, you conceived your baby at 45 naturally, right? Without
Yes.
any IVF. Okay. I just want to make sure that that's very clear and reiterated. So you talked about having to be, sounds like you trained yourself to look at pregnant women in a different way, to look at it as a blessing for you rather as something that you couldn't have. I can imagine that in the beginning, it probably didn't feel very authentic to you.
That's
Like,
correct. That's absolutely 100% correct. It felt awkward and stupid.
so can you kind of describe that process for women? Because I think women have I know women have a difficult time understanding that concept and being able to shift to that. So, like, how long did it take? What did you do, if you remember?
It wasn't just shifting my thinking around that. It was just, it's been a continual journey of shifting like my negative thinking. I think the clinical term for that is neuroticism. And in those psychology tests, I score high in neuroticism. So like I'm naturally inclined towards negative thinking. And it's definitely not easy. It feels stupid. Like I felt absolutely stupid when I was doing it, to be honest. And I didn't think it was gonna work at first, but and here's the thing. Like after I got divorced, I got a dating coach and I was working with her for about 6 months and I wasn't meeting anybody interesting. And I was starting to get like doubtful and cynical and depressed. And I asked her, like, what is the trait that your clients who end up meeting their man, like, what is the common trait with all those women? And she said, a belief that it's going to happen for them.
I
And I was
see.
like, huh. And that's like when I really realized how important having this belief in yourself was. Because that's all I had at that point. You know, I think I was like 40 or something. I'm Muslim. It's hard enough to get married when you're Muslim as it is, but if like you're a divorced Muslim, like in her 40s, it's like, yeah.
Or social pariah or something.
Yeah. You know? And so that was really all I had that was like pulling me towards my future was the belief that it would happen. And so when I finally met him and married him, I had like this success behind me that, you know, I could apply towards having a baby too, as unrealistic as that seemed. I knew that the belief was really like all I had, you know.
Yeah, it starts and ends with the belief. It has to start with the belief. Yes, for sure. And I can second what your dating coach said in regards to the motherhood journey. Those who have the belief, and that's what I work with women on, is cultivating that belief, because that belief has been trampled on. They had the belief at some point in their life, but it's been trampled on by their doctors and social media, and we have to rebuild it. And it is critical to success, because you can be doing IVF after IVF, and it will not be successful if you don't believe it. You're just going through the motions. And so, yeah, I wholeheartedly agree. Katie, is there anything else that you want to share about your motherhood journey that you think would be helpful for women that are going through what you have been through and that are looking for hope and inspiration?
Yeah, I think getting your body into shape, your health and nutrition, and making sure you're in the top shape of your life going into this is super important. I cut out sugar for the most part when I was trying to conceive because it increases inflammation in the body, which is, as you know, it's like, it's bad for conception or it's bad for
It's very
implanting.
inflammatory. Yes, I agree.
So that was no fun because I'm a chocoholic, but
Little pieces of dark chocolate here and there are okay, in moderation. As dark as you possibly can get it.
So if you know you need to lose some weight, I would make that a priority. I know people don't like to hear that, but if you're gonna go for this, like why not do it the right way?
Yeah, I agree, because the oldest client that I've had work with me who got pregnant was 47 at the time, and she was a
Yeah, not
trainer.
even.
She was a fitness trainer. I mean, like high level of fitness, and she was dealing with breast cancer, recovering from breast cancer. And so, yeah, and she beat the odds of everything. And so I know that if she can do it, I mean, there are no limits. And one of my really good friends, one of my best friends, she got pregnant. She ended up using IVF, but she used her own eggs. And I believe she was 48 at the time, if I remember correctly. She was in her late 40s. So she had her, and then she went on to have two babies 2 years apart from that same retrieval. But she was, I believe she was 48 at the time,
And
either
were they
47 or
48 year
48.
old eggs?
Yeah, they were
Wow.
48-year-old eggs. Yeah. And oh, and the point I bring her up is because she's also very, very fit, a fitness instructor, runs marathons and all that consistently. She's in her early 50s now. She still does, races and stuff like that, and still extreme, like she could be like a fitness model because she's so fit for her age. But yes, I do agree that It's a huge advantage to get into as good of a shape as you possibly can, for sure. Yeah, thank you. I wanted to go back. So is there anything else before I cut you off? Didn't mean to cut you off.
I guess just educate yourself on as many different modalities as you can. There's so many books, there are so many Facebook groups. I was in like three different Facebook groups, and I know like doctors hate it when you go on the internet for advice, but the Facebook groups were actually one of the most helpful things for me, because other women were like, we were like comparing test results and supporting each other and getting book recommendations and doctor recommendations. And there's just a ton of support out there for women 40 plus who are trying to get pregnant, like on Facebook. And it was actually in one of these groups was where I read a story about a woman who was 44 when she had her baby, and she had read the book It Starts with the Egg. And that was the first place I heard about that book. And I think that book had a major influence on my mindset and like how seriously I took my health.
It's impacted, it's had a fantastic impact on women. And so it's been, I know it's been a blessing for many, many women. So yeah, I'm glad you brought that up. But before we go, I actually want to go back to your drawings because I know that you do that for your living. And so you actually offer that as a service. So would you mind sharing a little bit about what you do?
So after I manifested my husband and my baby through drawing them, I started wondering, like, is this just a fluke, or is this, something that I can use to help other people? So I started trying it out, like, on friends and family to see if it would work. And I had some interesting early successes. And so I started offering it as a service for people who maybe they've had painful times or experiences in the past, and they want to like turn that around, like using the law of polarity, and end up manifesting what they want. And what that looked like for me was like I had a divorce, and I wanted to turn that around and meet the man of my dreams. And I had four miscarriages, so I wanted to turn that around and manifest a baby. So I'm working with clients now who want to manifest something in their life, and drawing it for them.
That's amazing skill. I'm so glad that you were able to use this for yourself, and you can do this now for really anyone who wants to manifest something bigger than what they already have, but also for women on their motherhood journey. Because if it worked for you, and certainly that wasn't the only thing, but it was an aspect of your success, right? And to be able to offer that to other women and to have that concrete image, to hold on to anchor your vision to. And that's just such a beautiful way of being able to move forward, having that tangible piece of evidence. Right. And so how do people get in touch with you if they want to work with you?
I can put my link in the chat, and that will take them to a page about my work, and they can schedule a Calendly meeting with me on that page, and
Perfect.
we can have a free 30-minute session to figure out if we're a good fit to work together.
Great.
So we'll paste that link below.
Yes, I will have that in the description below. Is there anything else that you wanted to say, Katie, before we sign off?
After learning about what you do, Julie, I highly encourage any women who are watching this to book a call with Julie and
Oh, thank you.
see if she might be a good fit to work with them.
Thank you so much, Katie. I really appreciate your time and sharing your just amazing story. And I know you're going to inspire a lot of women, for
Thank
sure.
you.
Thank
It's
you,
my hope.
Katie.